The stones of the high desert plateau tell the story of Chief Joseph Dam. They speak of a time thousands of years ago when the first peoples populated North America. A time when the ancestors of the Sinkayatek and the Nespelum tribes made the canyons of the Columbia River their home. The story is reflected in the waters of the Columbia, when glaciers covered the land with ice as much as a half a mile thick. As the climate warmed, the ice cap melted, causing a series of catastrophic floods to scour the Columbia Plateau, a gigantic basin of hardened lava and glacial soil into a pattern of hills and valleys, of great lakes and ancient waterfalls. The story is one of heritage and pride. It draws its name from Chief Joseph, famous leader of the Wallawa band of Nez Perce Indians in Oregon Territory. In 1877, Chief Joseph led his band and other Nez Perce, totaling in the hundreds, on an epic 1,700-mile journey out of northeastern Oregon to seek freedom in Canada. Captured in northern Montana, just short of the Canadian border, Chief Joseph was eventually exiled here to the Colville Reservation, where he lived out his final days. Chief Joseph, humanitarian, military strategist, and powerful statesman, highly admired for his wisdom, bravery, loyalty, and commitment to peace. The story is told in concrete and steel, one of North America's mightiest hydroelectric projects, part of a complex system of public and private dams providing electricity, flood control, and irrigation in the upper Columbia River Basin stretching into Canada. Chief Joseph Dam is a run-of-the-river dam devoted mainly to electricity generation, so it is rare to see water passing over the spillway. Today, it remains the second largest producer of hydropower in the United States, second only to Grand Coulee Dam. Chief Joseph Dam is a story of front-page significance. Rufus Woods, editor of the Wenatchee World newspaper, fought for public development of the Columbia River and led the fight in the 1930s for both Grand Coulee and Chief Joseph Dams. In a supporting editorial, he wrote, "The greatest waste in America today is the tremendous loss of this power running to waste when it ought to be used in constructive effort for and in behalf of the economy and country." Grand Coulee Dam was completed by the Bureau of Reclamation in 1942, and after years of debate, Congress passed a measure in 1946 authorizing the Army Corps of Engineers to begin construction of what was then called Foster Creek Dam. It was so named for its location directly upstream from the mouth of Foster Creek, but was later changed to Chief Joseph Dam in honor of the great chief. The dam, Congress reasoned, would pay for its original $145 million construction cost in less than 50 years, a conservative estimate in light of the fact that today, Chief Joseph Dam produces power in excess of $1 million a day. 14 different dam sites were considered, and a number of designs were closely examined. The final design utilized buttonhook rock, a surfacing portion of the underlying bedrock, as an integral anchor, allowing the powerhouse to extend at an angle downstream. By turning the river's flow sideways, Chief Joseph Dam would maximize power generation. Construction of a fish ladder was originally envisioned, but since Grand Coulee Dam, the next dam upriver, had been constructed without a fish ladder, officials believed a dam located directly upstream from Foster Creek would not significantly impact existing fish runs between the two dams. The first earth movers went to work in 1949 with a crew of several hundred carpenters, iron workers, and other skilled technicians and laborers filling the Columbia River Valley at Bridgeport. The right abutment was coffered off first, a process in which a portion of the river was sealed off and pumped dry in order to permit construction. Meanwhile, the river flowed naturally on the left half. The mighty Columbia rebelled against man's attempt to harness her power with repeated flooding during construction. Notwithstanding setbacks, the engineers and workers pressed on. With their ingenuity and persistence, they prevailed. After the right abutment was high enough above water level, the river was passed through sluiceways as the left side was coffered off. A 240-foot high wall, approximately 1.8 million cubic yards of reinforced concrete, began to take shape. A volume of concrete so immense that it would fill a line of concrete trucks stretching from Chief Joseph Dam to Mexico.
Chief Joseph Dam. The tremendous structure is completed, intended to become one of the largest producers of hydroelectric power. Its statistics are impressive. Figures tell many things. However, when they assume such immense proportions, the average human imagination is left behind.
After 7 years of construction, statesmen, tribal members, construction workers, and residents of the Columbia River Plateau gathered in June of 1956 for the dedication of Chief Joseph Dam. They came to celebrate what was at the time the longest straight-line power plant in the world, close to half a mile in length. Today, the 27 turbine generators generate more than enough electricity to meet the needs of even the largest Northwest city, Seattle.